Hello, my name is Nitin. I have finally received a pre-release version of MAGPy version 1.0 from SPEAG for testing. As you can see, I haven't even opened the box yet. So, you will witness today firsthand the initial user experience. I plan to test the device in more detail in follow-up videos. As you know, MAGPy stands for Magnetic Amplitude and Gradient Probe System, and it promises a lot more than any comparable electromagnetic exposure meter, as it not only enables to demonstrate compliance with the field limits or reference limits of the various standards, but much more importantly with the basic restrictions that are the limits for peak spatial specific absorption rate or SAR and induced E-fields or current density, and all this without using the robot. The main purpose of MAGPy is to demonstrate compliance through in situ evaluation of strong magnetic field sources operating between 3 kHz and 10 MHz. Examples are automotive wireless power transfer systems, induction heating, industrial welding, and any other high power EM sources. At the first moment, the MAGPy feels a bit larger and heavier than expected, but the handle fits well into the hand. As you see, MAGPy is composed of the probe, the data acquisition system called the MAGPy DAS, and the Microsoft Surface tablet, which runs the MAGPy software. The tablet is attached to the system with these white wings and is connected to the MAGPy DAS with the integrated USB cable. The MAGPy H8 3D 1E 3D probe includes 8 fully isotropic H-field sensors and 1 isotropic E-field sensor, all integrated in the tip of the probe. Details of the probe design and specifications are available on the SPEAG website. MAGPy is shipped fully assembled, installed with the latest software version and pre-charged. It is shipped with the charger and an extra long USB cable. All you need to know is available in the calibration document which comes with the box. This is a leaflet, MAGPy at a glance. I was told that this little leaflet is sufficient to operate the system. We will see. As a backup, the complete manual is also pre-installed on the tablet. For this brief demonstration, I use this magnetic field source V-coil 350 by 85 from SPEAG. This is a source developed for the validation of the DAISY 8 module WPT, the robot-based single probe system I had demonstrated last summer. It is also compatible with the IEC PAS 63184. First, I switch on the tablet and then the MAGPy DAS using the button here, and I start the application. I click start. Nice. Here I see the H field spectrum. The spectrum shows all components from 3 kHz to 10 MHz. I can zoom in on the dominant components by swiping with my finger over the display. The source here is tuned to 85 kHz, and this is shown here. The marker shows the peak frequency and its magnitude. I can easily zoom out by double click on the graph. I can also use the two finger touch to zoom in. The field components X, Y, Z can be visualized together or separately along with the total values. The field can also be displayed as numerical values. As expected, the Z component of the magnetic field is dominant in the center of the coil with low values for X and Y components. The total field is nearly the same as the Z component. The total magnetic field at this point is already relatively high, 58 amperes per meter at 83 kilohertz, while the ECNIRP limit for incident magnetic field at 85 kilohertz is 21 ampere per meter. The field is thus a factor of approximately 9 dB above the limits. If I switch to relative mode, it shows the ratio of measured field and limit as 8.8 dB. The display shows the latest as well as the maximum values for the field. So, I move the device towards the source. The maximum values are updated, and as I move back, these remain constant. The field can also be visualized in the time domain. The incident E field value is shown in this window here. These are quite low as this is a magnetic field source. If I switch to relative mode, we are indeed 12 dB below the limit for incident E field values. The unique feature of this device is that it also measures the H field gradient that is very important for compliance. The H field gradient in 1 by meter and the percentage contribution of the Z component of the gradient to the total value is shown in the gradient window here. In the center of the coil, I expect relatively moderate gradients. At this location, the gradient is 11.9 with the dominant component being the Z component, which is in the direction of the axis of the probe. The MAGPy thus collects information about the H field, its gradient, as well as the E field. This information is presented in practically useful and powerful display formats. I must say, these features are really impressive and are not available in any other device I have come across so far. Let us further investigate the other features of this device. The top of the user interface window shows the current software version, the battery status for the MAGPy DAS as well as the tablet. MAGPy already has several standard limits pre-programmed for comparison with measured values. Let's see. So, we have ECNIRP, we have FCC, HC code sys, and IEEE limits. Compliance for both occupational and general public environments can be selected, and the limits are applied accordingly. In this window here, I select the analysis bandwidth and the frequency. Obviously, I set the frequency for this source to 85 kHz and the analysis bandwidth to be sufficiently wide, let's say 50 kHz. Now, here is the exciting part of this device. In this bar here, the estimated induced E field is displayed and below is the estimated induced SAR. If I switch to relative mode, I see that the incident H field is 8.4 dB above the limit, but the conservatively estimated induced E field is 1.24 dB below the limit. This means that the device is compliant with the basic restriction and therefore with the safety guidelines, even though the reference levels are violated. Very powerful. MAGPy can demonstrate compliance for sources which cannot be accessed by any other device. Buttons on the right allow the user to start or stop a measurement, clear the max hold values for a fresh evaluation, toggle between absolute and relative values, switch the induced field windows from frequency or time domain to numerical modes, save a screenshot or measurement data to the connected USB drive as well as the MAGPy device. These buttons are easily operated with the thumb. Additional buttons on the right side provide for changing the graphical views from log to linear modes for both X and Y axis. Changing the orientation of buttons, this is a neat feature to help left-handed users. Changing the theme of display to dark or light modes. The configure settings button allows to adjust software settings. These settings include information about the software version and the version of the components, a link to the user manual, language of operation. SPEAG already supports English, Dutch, Japanese, Korean, and Mandarin. Default compliance standard and the exposure situation. Evaluation at the probe tip or the center of the probe. Type of detector, RMS or peak for the fields shown in the incident windows. Signal acquisition time per data point and also options to switch the screen from full screen to the maximum modes. Just for fun, I want to determine the safety or compliance boundary of this validation source, assuming it is mounted to the wall. That's all pretty straightforward. The only thing that is not so intuitive is that the device evaluates the exposure in a well-defined orientation with respect to the exposed body. This means that the probe estimates the induced fields for fields penetrating the body in the direction of the probe axis. For this coil mounted at the wall, the probe is oriented horizontally like this. First, I select the settings. Next, we move the device slowly towards the center of the coil and observe the latest relative incident edge field value. So at this point, the relative incident edge field value in dB begins to turn positive, which means this is the boundary for incident edge field and is approximately 15 centimeters from the tip of the probe to the source. So this would be the compliance boundary for conventional evaluations. However, the induced fields are still much lower. To find out the compliance boundary for the induced E field, I move the probe further towards the source and observe the current relative value of the induced electric field till it becomes zero or positive. So this point therefore corresponds to the compliance boundary for the induced quantities. This distance is approximately 2 centimeters on the tip of the coil to the source. Even above the actual coil, which is the location of the highest field level. The incident edge field at this location is 9 dB above the limit, that is a factor of 9 dB. Thus, the compliance gain is a factor of about 9 dBs. This is very exciting. This simple example effectively illustrates the uniqueness of the MAGPy device. Conventional field meters that measure the incident fields set the compliance boundary at 7 times that actually required if induced quantities are evaluated. MAGPy overcomes this limitation by directly measuring the induced quantities. The MAGPy system is unique in its application, as It measures not only the field components of the E and H fields, but also their gradients. These measurements allow the user to test compliance by comparing directly with the basic restrictions instead of the reference levels, and thus offers several dB advantage due to reduction in overestimation built into the reference levels. The system is intuitive, easy to use, and yet offers the unmatched precision which has become synonymous with any SPEAG product. Thanks for watching this video.